Hello there, my fellow defenseless ultra marines, and welcome back to our series on famous battles and campaigns of the 40k universe. For today, it is episode number 4 on our Battle of Calth coverage. And oh boy, there are still a lot more to come. I might have actually underestimated the number of episodes this series will have. But for today, we are going to continue learning about a meager defense from orbit that the 13th Legion and their allies did muster. Before I begin though, this video will be getting out on the 31st of December, so I just wanted to take a moment and wish everyone a good time and a happy new year. The very best of wishes from my one-man team here. I am your host, the Grimdark Narrator, and without further ado, let us proceed, shall we? As the southern island cities were being pounded into dust and vapor, the battle in the void was spilling ever further across Calth near space. The world was ringed by no less than 900 orbital defense platforms, each one bristling with lance turrets, weapon batteries, and torpedo tubes. However, each one had been rendered as defenseless as a freighter by the usurpation of the defense grid command system. Many of these platforms, even the smallest of which had several hundred crew, were engaged by passing word-bearer warships, while others were simply ignored. A number of them, however, were singled out for destruction or boarding, again suggesting the existence of an underlying and esoteric pattern to the entire attack. In a phenomenon that would be repeated many times, the word-bearers sought out specific enemies to slay in a specific way, as if in doing so they would honor their Primarch or some other higher power. Across Calth near space, boarding torpedoes and assault claws exploded from the launch bays of the Wordbearer vessels, to smash into the armored flanks of scores of defense platforms. Even as the assault claws fusion burned through meters of armor, the defenders of the platforms mustered. All available hands were scrambled to oppose the Wordbearer boarding parties, but it was the Solar Auxilia stationed on each platform that would bear the brunt of the fighting. While not as strong or heavily armed or armored as the Legiones Astartes they would be fighting, these defenders were nevertheless the elite of the human forces defending Calth. Configured according to the long-approved and highly efficient solar pattern, these units were equipped with vacuum-warded void armor, and so could fight even in the areas depressurized by the breaching of a platform's outer skin. While not as potent as the Legiones Astartes bolters, their weapons were still capable of inflicting significant damage when massed against their targets, and they also had the advantage that they could never really miss in the platform's cramped interiors. The greatest advantage that the Solar Auxilia had over the other lesser troops and press station hands was their chain of command, though. Well organized and relentlessly drilled in every facet of the Zone Mortalis warfare, they could be relied upon to stand resolute against any kind of enemy, and if necessary, die in the pursuit of their sacred duty. On 100 orbital defense stations and more, the Wordbearers' boarding parties forced their way along the platform passageways. They were met by the torrential blizzards of laser, plasma, and flame. The defenders were on home ground, and had trained many times to undertake such duty, and so they made the boarders pay dearly for every meter they gained. The Wordbearers, though, weathered the storm, striding inexorably into the very jaws of death. Ceramite armor cracked and degraded layer by layer as round after round impacted, but very few were actually killing blows that the defenders could land. So, with lethal inevitability, the Legiones Astartes closed on the defenders' positions. Even then, the Solar Auxilia enacted tactical protocols born of generations of void warfare, mastered by their Saturnine forebears. Las rifle sections fell back along preordained routes, while Velatari's storm sections held the attackers at bay with fearsome volleys of Volkite fire and searing blasts of flame. Others simply held their position as long as they could, maintaining a steady rate of fire as death came for them, determined to the last to buy their comrades time to fall back into the next defensible position. But the Wordbearers were gaining footholds, and ultimately the bold defenders were doomed. As the battle spilled deeper into the guts of the defense platforms, the passageways and chambers were transformed into abattoirs. In places, the defenders' resolve was sorely tested when confronted with the unfamiliar combat doctrines certain Wordbearer legionaries employed. Some chanted mournful playsong as they advanced, an atonal dirge filling the hearts of all that heard it with dread. Others halted after every kill, pausing to enact grisly mutilation upon the recently fallen. In still more cases, the Wordbearers refrained from slaying cornered or overrun enemies, instead handing them off to the following mortal units to clap them in irons and take them away as prisoners. The fate of these unfortunates can only be guessed at, but you can be certain it was not a pleasant one. On a scant handful of orbital installations, the Solar Auxilia defenders were successful in repelling the Wordbearers, but not without paying a heavy price indeed. On platform Principia Viridia 27-K, a sub-cohort of the 222nd Calth Solar Auxilia rad-purged an entire marshalling deck, just as the Wordbearers' breaching parties forced their way on board. The resulting flood of radiation was so intense that even the transhuman physiologies of the attacking Astartes could not protect them. The first of the attackers wavered, and then the auxiliaries of the 222nd fixed bayonets and charged. Their solar pattern void armor able to fend off the radiation only for so long as it took the charge to strike home. Dozens of the stricken legionaries were overrun before they could react, and mere seconds later, the auxiliaries themselves fell victim to the radiation. Not one warrior from either side survived, the rad-flooded chamber forming a tomb for enemies locked in a mutual death struggle. The defense of platform Ellipsia Viridia 09-Q was equally successful and equally deadly for both sides. In this instance, it is thought that a substantial force of Terminator-armored Wordbearers utilized a rare teleportarium array to board the station and launch an attack on the station's primary strategium. The station master had just a few moments to react, and so mounted a noble, if futile, defense of the bridge. The attack had bypassed the large sub-cohort of the 255th Calth Solar Auxilia stationed there, the Wordbearers judging that the defense would collapse with the strategium captured. This did not occur, however, for the 255th was commanded by veteran Lord Marshal Turnus, a beloved leader and bringer of many victories to his name. Determined to strike back at the traitors, even if it cost his life, Turnus ordered the station's Mechanicum Magos Prime to overload the platform's reactor. The Magos refused, and so the Lord Marshal shot him in the head. His deputy, however, acceded when the Lord Marshal repeated the order, and within just a few minutes the entire platform was consumed in atomic fire. Elsewhere still, even the elite of the Solar Auxilia could not stem the inexorable tide of the Wordbearers. Valiant troopers died in their thousands, and at last, the Wordbearers' intent in boarding specific orbital defense platforms was revealed. This was just as the same scene was enacted upon the bridges of scores of defense platforms. The commanders taken alive were forced to witness to the destruction heaped upon the worlds whose defenses they were sworn to. Compelled to watch by the vice grips of the Wordbearers' dark apostles or other senior officers, the last sight these men and women saw served as a vital component in a vast and terrible ritual unfolding on Calth. Much later, it was determined that the intent of this cruelty was to sear the sight of a dying world into each victim's consciousness as an act of witnessing. This was a scene the Wordbearers believed the dead would take with them to the afterlife, as evidence to the power that holds sway over the traitor legion's deeds. 2 hours into the orbital battle, the master of the Vox of the Ultramarines flagship reported to Guilliman that the Wordbearer's flagship, the Fidelitas Lex, had finally opened a lithocast hailing channel. The Primarch of the Ultramarines stepped into the holocaster platform at the center of the bridge, as the hooded figure of the Primarch Lorgar manifested before him in a grainy light. Maybe for the first time in his life, Guilliman was lost to anger. He raged at his brother for the betrayal and swore to enact merciless vengeance. Guilliman denounced Lorgar's very sanity, and swore that he and all his sons would be punished. But Lorgar simply listened to all of this with a smirk upon his face. The remainder of his face was hidden in shadow, and he was not the being Guilliman had once known. No longer was Lorgar the cerebral seeker of the truth, who had debated the nature of the universe with his brother Magnus. Nor was he the overzealous son who had brought upon himself the censure of the Emperor, that he himself had declared a god. Neither was Lorgar the chastened warrior who alone of all the Primarchs sought not to conquer, but to bring enlightenment. Here, instead, was a transcendent being, radiating a newfound purpose and self-assurance. As if he and he alone was party to knowledge still hidden from others, but which they would soon learn whether they wanted it or not. No longer cowed or eclipsed before a more overtly purposeful or assured Primarch, Lorgar was the very essence of phlegmatic defiance. More shocking than even Lorgar's manner, however, were the words that he spoke to Guilliman. With scornful derision, he informed the Lord of Ultramar that, contrary to Guilliman's assumption, Lorgar's treachery was not vengeance for Monarchia, and neither was this an isolated event. Rather, it was part of a long scheme of impossible scope and ambition, with no less than half the number of their brother Primarchs complicit in it, including the first among equals, the Archdouchebag Horus. Three of their brothers, Lorgar claimed at this time, were in fact dead, a claim that history would reveal as erroneous, yet which he himself had every cause to make at the time. Guilliman was rendered speechless by the staggering hubris in Lorgar's words, yet he knew that his brother was speaking the truth, horrifying as it may have been. In that moment, he swore anew to end his brother's betrayal, even if it was the last thing he would do, even if it was revealed as utterly contrary to sound tactics and sane strategy. Guilliman's intent at that moment was to hunt Lorgar down and kill him with his own bare hands. And this, my friends, has been what I wanted to tell you on the Battle of Calth for today, chiefly the valiant defense of the orbital platforms by the Solar Auxilia. Next time, we will actually talk about the defense of the McCrag's Honor itself, the Ultramarine's flagship, a section of the battle that Guilliman participates in directly. So do stay tuned for that. If you have any thoughts or questions on today's section of the topic, as always, you are more than welcome to share them below. Was the episode informative or entertaining? In that case, please click the like button and subscribe for future content. And do click the bell icon to stay a bit more up to date. Thank you very much for watching, and I wish you all a great and peaceful day. The Emperor protects.